Birdie and runs that. On Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock, we're going to have a midweek fellowship meeting, which I know is always well attended. So that's all these things are on Zoom, by the way. So if you want to join us on Zoom, Sandra, you can do it. I just know you can. Okay, you said that last week. So yeah, try and join us on Zoom. It's always great. It's lovely to see new people on Zoom. So please try and join us. That's 7 o'clock midweek meeting on Wednesday. That's okay, no worries. That's okay. Go on, I'll leave you to sort that out. Okay, and then on Friday morning, Friday afternoon at 2 o'clock, we've got our drop-in as well. And that's just a little bit of fellowship, just to drop in and have yourselves a cup of coffee and a chat. It's just a little bit of fellowship, and that's normally a really good laugh as well. On Thursday this week, I think Anne might have sent you, an email. Elim are having a time of prayer, national prayer, so get on board that. So that's loads of stuff to do this week. So no excuse for laziness, okay?
Amen.
Okay, we're going to carry on reading through the book of Acts today, this morning. I can say this morning now. Amen. And reading from Acts 4:32 through to Acts 5:11. And the catchy title for my sermon this morning is, what do we do when God is doing what we don't expect him to do? What do we do when God is doing what we don't expect him to do? If you're the kind of Christian who thinks they've got the measure of God, you've got God all sussed out and worked out, you know how he's going to react. You've got him in a nice, comfortable box. Well, this particular story this morning will blow all that thinking out of the water. It's a story I'm sure you're familiar with. It's the story of Ananias and Sapphira. So I'm reading from the NIV version and starting, as I say, on Acts 4:32. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There were no needy persons among them, for as many as owned land or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. Please switch your mobile phones off. Thank you. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. There was a Levite, a native of Cyprus, Joseph, to whom the apostles gave the name Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold a field that belonged to him and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. Then we move on to chapter 5. But a man named Ananias, with the consent of his wife Sapphira, sold a piece of property. With his wife's knowledge, he kept some of the proceeds back and brought only part and laid it at the apostles' feet. Ananias, Peter asked, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back part of the proceeds of the land? While it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, were not the proceeds at your disposal? How is it that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You did not lie to us, but to God. Now when Ananias heard these words, he fell down and died. And great fear seized all who heard it. The young men came and wrapped up his body, then carried him out and buried him. After an interval of about 3 hours, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. Peter said to her, tell me whether you and your husband sold the land for such and such a price. And she said, yes, that was the price. Then Peter said to her, how is it that you have agreed together to put the Spirit of the Lord to the test? Look, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out. Immediately she fell down at his feet and died. When the young men came in, they found her dead, so they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. And great fear seized whole church and all who heard these things. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word, for your life-giving word. This morning, Lord Jesus, we pray that you will teach us through your word. And Lord, you would help us to know at times when we're not certain of what's happening, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would just help us to have that understanding, Lord. Bring it to our heart, the understanding of the things you do, Lord, which are always good. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this story has an echo. You know, sometimes in Scripture there'll be stories that have an echo. Sometimes in the Old Testament, or if it's in the Old Testament, in the New Testament. Sometimes a story that is very, very similar. In fact, too similar for it to be a coincidence. And some of you will know that there's an echo of this particular story in the Old Testament, in the book of Joshua. A man named Achan kept back items for himself when the Jews had looted Jericho. He was stoned to death. So that's an echo of the story here. And sometimes when Scripture gives us that echo, when it emphasizes what's being said, it emphasizes it because this is a very, very serious thing. So what do we do when God is doing what we don't expect him to do? You know, in life, there's always opportunists, isn't there? There's always chancers, chiselers, tricksters, blindsiders. We always find them in society, don't we? Not in this church, but nobody in this church. And they're certainly there in Scripture, aren't they? Right through Scripture, we always find these people. The sort of pantomime villains. If Scripture would be a sort of a black and white movie from the beginning of the last century, some of these people would have handlebar moustaches. Because the baddies always had handlebar moustaches. That's how you told them apart in the old films. Jackie's obviously seen them. Well, certainly when in the area that I was growing up, there were quite a few really quite nasty characters. Most of the gang that we had hang out with were pretty nice characters, but some of them weren't. And one of those guys was a guy called Irish. So called because he was Irish. In fact, I don't even know why we called him Irish. I think we just ran out of nicknames, but we called him Irish anyway. His name was Irish, and he was like one of our gang. We didn't want him in our gang, but he joined our gang. He sort of infiltrated our gang when we were youngsters. And he was a big bloke and a brusque bloke. Basically, if he said today was Friday. Well, he joined our gang anyway. We didn't want him in our gang, but he was in our gang. Big Irish. And if any of you remember Penny for the Guy, I'm sure you do, when you'd go to people's houses and try and get a penny for the guy. Well, some of our friends decided when we were very young to go Penny for the Guy, and Irish decided to come with us. So we decided that each of us would take a turn. On the Monday, I would make the guy and go around, and I would collect the money, I'd be the front man, and then we'd carve it up between us at the end of the day. And I remember we always had about 30 pence each. A lot of money back in the early 70s, friends. So we had about 30 pence each. That was the amount of money we had. So everyone took the turn. The next day was Gordon's turn, the next day was somebody's. And at the end of the week, it was Irish's turn to make the guy and to be the collector of the money. So he made this guy, was the worst guy ever. So it was a sort of a cauliflower on a stick, basically. But we went round, it was his turn, you know, everyone had played their part. And sure enough, he was the front man, he collected the money, we went on and on. And at the end of the night, we put all the money on the floor, we carved it all up between us. The next minute, Irish grabbed all the money, shoved it in his pocket, ran home, and shut his door and locked it. I know, even to this day, I'm scarred by this. That was 30 pence. 6 Mars bars you could get for 30 pence in those days. I thought, actually, should I know these no claim and no payment? I thought maybe I should try and get my 30 pence back from Bugsy with one of these claim companies. How much would 30 pence be worth these days? Probably about 20. Maybe I should go down that road. But even as a kid, you knew that there was these people around. And certainly in the Bible, we hear of these chancers, these bad pantomime villains, these nasty people. Even good people who were being a little bit duplicious and a little bit sneaky. And certainly Ananias and Sapphira came under that. Well, if we look to the Bible, right, really through Bible history, certainly Old Testament history, and any Bible book that has got an ongoing story to it, that has a narrative to it, well, there's bad characters in nearly all the books of the Bible, certainly in the Old Testament. Here's some examples. Laban tricked Jacob into working an additional 7 years for the hand of Rachel. Amnon tricked Tamar into sleeping with him. Pharaoh made promises to Moses and reneged on them. Jezebel forged her husband's signature to cheat Naboth out of his vineyard. Potiphar's wife told lies about Joseph. Lot's daughters deceived their father. Rachel stole items from her father and lied about the whereabouts. Abraham lied that Sarah was his sister and his son named Isaac. Haman tricked the king into making a decree to kill all Jews. Really, from the very beginning, even as early as the first book of, or sorry, the second book of Genesis, we've got the serpent being duplicitous and tricking Adam and Eve into eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, eating fruit from that tree. Even as early as the book of Genesis, there was sneakiness going on, blindsidedness, chiseling going on. And in recent memory to this story, we know that Judas Iscariot, probably the biggest opportunist scripture has ever known, maybe even society has ever known, betrayed Jesus and got him arrested and killed. And that's the great thing. But he rose again. Amen.
Amen.
So that's the great thing about scripture for me. It's brutally honest, isn't it? It's not a glossy mag to sell God to us. It is a brutally honest book. And it says about the things that are going on, all these horrible things that are going on. And even the good people of scripture fell, didn't they? And it doesn't, scripture makes no apology for that. And I think that's a great thing. Do you?
Yeah.
Good. Okay. So it's not a glossy man. It's not a book of heroes. Even the heroes messed up and failed. And the Bible's very explicit on these things. So what's happening here in the story that we've read this morning? So let's look at four scenarios. Number one, Ananias and Sapphira were genuine believers who were simply being a bit prudent. Ananias and Sapphira were genuine believers who were just being a little bit prudent. Do you know there was nothing wrong with Ananias and Sapphira keeping back some of that sale money for themselves? There would have been nothing wrong with that if they had just been honest about it. Peter said, while it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, were not the proceeds at your disposal? So was it wrong not to give the total amount? I'm looking for an answer.
No.
If they had just kept 15% aside and been honest with Peter, and been honest in front of God, there would not have been a problem. And I wouldn't have had anything to read this morning. There is nothing wrong with making concessions for the future without money. There's nothing wrong with that. You know, Joseph did that, didn't he, at the time when he was superintendent of Egypt. The Pharaoh had a dream that there'd be 7 good years and 7 bad years, 7 years of famine, feast and famine, and Joseph kept back some stuff to ensure that they had enough food and grain, etc., for the barren years. So there's nothing wrong with keeping a little bit back, as long as we don't keep ridiculous amounts back. You know, that's okay, that's prudential thinking, that's okay. But they didn't do that, did they? Ananias and Sapphira didn't do that. They kept stuff back and pretended that they'd given everything. And the important thing to note is, in fact, right through this story is, this story has nothing at all to do with money. Nothing at all to do with money. In a money-obsessed society, if they read this, they'd probably think, it's the money, it's nothing to do with money at all. Ananias and Sapphira could easily have kept that money back if they were just being honest. So, were they genuine believers who were just being prudent? Number two scenario. Ananias and Sapphira were genuine believers who thought they could get away with a little bit of dishonesty. Who thought God would just turn a blind eye. After all, they're giving 90%, just keep 10% back. Keep it to ourselves. Nobody else will know. Only us. Do we ever try that? Can we get away with a little bit of dishonesty in the way that Ananias I used to work in the car part of a car warehouse, and we kept loads and loads of big parts and stuff for cars. It was a good company called Alfords. They were a really good company. And part of my job, because we couldn't all keep all parts in, some specialist parts we had to order out. And part of my job was to go to the goods inputs department, and the drivers would deliver the stuff that we didn't stock. I'd sign a little chitty, and I'd put it in a little box for a customer. It was a really exciting job. I really enjoyed it. And every time the people would deliver, there'd be like, I guess, about five or six deliveries every hour. They'd ring the bell, I'd answer the door, sign the little chitty, take the box, and that, and everything went on much as before. But one guy that used to deliver used to ask me to sign two pieces of paper. That was meant to be a drum roll. Bum, bum, bum. Or as they do in EastEnders. He used to ask me to sign two pieces of paper, two sheets of paper. And I thought it was a bit odd. So after about 5 or 6 weeks, I said, excuse me if you don't mind my asking, but when you deliver the part, you always ask me to sign two pieces of paper. Everyone else just asks me to sign one piece of paper. Why is that? He said, oh, it's as simple as this, he said. You're signing for the part I just delivered, and then you're also signing to say that I've come round in the afternoon as a courtesy call. He said, because I'm paid to do that. He said, but I call round as a courtesy to all the companies, and none of them ever want anything from me. So all the people who got goods inwards signed to say I've come round just to save me a journey. I said, well, I'm not signing. I'm not signing to say you've been round when you haven't been round. He said, sorry? I said, I'm not signing a piece of paper to tell a lie. Now that's a very, very small thing, and I'm sure something that, you know, in the great scheme of things isn't important, and it wasn't important. But you know what, I'm standing there as a representative of God, as a representative of Jesus. This may be tacky, I'm not doing it. So he said, well, you have to get your manager then. So the manager came, and the manager said, Keith, just sign it. I said, no. I'm not signing. He said, Keith, just sign it. I said, no. So we agreed that whenever this delivery driver would come, I would get a member of staff, and if they were happy to sign, they could sign, but I would not sign. And that got me into a lot of trouble. There was a lot of guys I had to get from the warehouse to sign. I said, if you want to sign, that's fine, but I'm not signing. And it created a lot of problems. A lot of those guys were really aggressive with me. But I made a stand. Do you know why I made a stand? Because in signing that tiny little piece of paper, it didn't matter. I was entering into a covenant of deceit with that guy, and that was wrong. So where do we stand when these things happen? Where do we stand when we're driving into a car park and we're just about to put our money in? And these are serious scenarios this morning to think about. It's not a joke. When we're driving into a car park and we're going to pay for 2 hours and we're just about to put the money in, and a guy is driving up and winds down his window and says, it's okay, I've got a voucher for 3 hours, I've paid for 3 hours, and I've only used it for 10 minutes, you can have that. And you look at the voucher and it says, not transferable. And you look at a big sign and it says, not transferable. What do? Do you take it? Or are we being dishonest? Serious question. When somebody comes up to you and says, oh, I work for Boots, and I've got a card just for the staff, and I get 50% staff discount off everything. It's just for me though, it's only for me. But hey, whatever you want to get, tell me and I'll get it for you with my staff 50% discount. And you look at the card and it says, not transferable for the staff only. How do we react to that? What do we do? What do we say? What do we say when there's a sign that says, keep off the grass, and we know that cutting across the grass will knock 10 minutes off our journey? How do we respond when it says keep off the grass? My suggestion is that we keep off the grass. My suggestion is when they say wear masks. All those scenarios incidentally were scenarios that me and Ruth have met with in recent years. But I don't want to stand here as some bastion of all kind of wonderfulness and other. I'm just saying, it is tricky at times, isn't it? To make those stands. It's a dishonest world. Dishonesty is so rampant now, the lines are blurred. We don't even know what's honest and what's not honest anymore. So were Ananias and Sapphira genuine believers who thought they could get away with a little dishonesty? Peter said to her, tell me whether you and your husband sold the land for such and such a price. And she said, yes, that was the price. Sapphira did not know that her husband was dead, but Peter seems to be giving her a chance to repent here, which lends itself to thinking that perhaps they were believers who were just trying it on. So scenario number three, and I've got four this morning, so we're nearly halfway through. Don't ever believe a preacher when he says we're nearly halfway through. We're nearly halfway through the scenarios. So scenario number three, Ananias and Sapphira were genuine believers who, overcome with guilt, simply collapsed and died. At no point in this story does the text say they were struck down by God. When Ananias heard these words, this is reading from scripture, he fell down and died, and Sapphira, immediately she fell down at his feet, at Peter's feet, and died. Could they have had a heart attack and collapsed with fear? Could Peter have pronounced some sort of death sentence on them for the things he was saying? You know, some writers, some scholars, because this particular story has scholars and Bible experts from one end of the scale to the other really tearing their hair out. Some of them say that Peter put a curse on Ananias and Sapphira. I don't personally think he did. The language of this narrative suggests a divine judgment. So were Ananias and Sapphira genuine believers who were overcome with guilt and simply collapsed and died? Number four, Ananias and Sapphira were outsiders who were trying to infiltrate the church. Ananias and Sapphira were outsiders who were trying to infiltrate the church. There's a lot of scholarly opinion that leans on this particular scenario. A lot of writers believe that Ananias and Sapphira could have been Pharisees trying to spy out the apostles and find out about their teaching. Remember, Jesus had only in recent memory massively defeated Satan when he came back to life. This was Satan's first opportunity to sow some sort of disharmony and discord in the life of the apostles. Remember that up to this point, everything had been really, really good. Everything with the apostles has been pretty much good. Peter says, "Why has Satan filled your heart?" He says that to Ananias, doesn't he? Ananias. Why would he say that if they were born again? Why would he say that if they were believers? Wouldn't they have the Holy Spirit in their heart? If they were outsiders who would come in to infiltrate, if they were Pharisees, or somebody else coming from the outside to infiltrate, well, why didn't the Holy Spirit simply reveal this to Peter? How can somebody who is unseen lie to the Holy Spirit? I don't think you can if you're unseen. If unbelievers were simply trying to get a foot into Christianity and were deceptive, would they have brought such a judgment from God? If they were unbelievers, why did Peter give Sapphira the opportunity to repent? And if they were Pharisees, why didn't Peter say, quite simply, get out? So were the outsiders trying to infiltrate the church? So which of these scenarios is right then? And you can work out your own one. Ruth's scratching her head. Which of these scenarios is right? Can you do us a favor before we carry on? Can you just give us a smile? Really, it means a lot, thank you. Just to prove I'm doing something right. So which of these scenarios is right? Ananias and Sapphira were part of the apostles. They were curious. They were non-believers. Were they a plant? Was their act prudent, deceptive, plain ill-advised, downright stupid, or demonic of origin? Were they struck dead by God himself, cursed by Peter, or did they die of shock? Could they have even have been trying to buy their way into Christianity? That's another scenario. Do you know, in a sense, I've said all these scenarios this morning, but the bigger issue here is that God is making a stand against hypocrisy. There are over 100 scriptures, I believe, where God addresses hypocrisy. And it seemed to be the only thing that really wound Jesus up, didn't it? But the Pharisees seemed to really get him going, was the hypocrisy. And he's making a stand against it now. Hypocrisy from within and hypocrisy from without. Remember, we've agreed this morning, haven't we, that it was a duplicitous society. We've seen that everywhere in Scripture. Somebody was up to something. So right here, God is drawing a line and purifying the church at its earliest point. That's what I believe. Everything in the church so far, as I said, was going swimmingly well. The Holy Spirit had filled the apostles. Peter talked to the crowd. They all heard in their own language. 3,000 were believed and baptized after Peter's first sermon. That's not bad going, is it? They had a little bit of trouble from some of the leaders at the time, but they got through that. A man crippled from birth had been miraculously healed, and the apostles had the respect of everyone in Israel. So up to that point, everything seemed to be going really well, didn't it? But Ananias and Sapphira were undoing all the good work of the apostles with hypocrisy. So did the punishment fit the crime is a bigger question perhaps this morning. What do we do when God is doing what we don't expect him to do? Does the punishment fit the crime? Is it, in a sense, a bit of an overreaction from God? Hope not in that word. I was speaking to my mum recently. I speak to her on the phone every week. And she was asking me, she said, you know, what are you preaching on Sunday? And I said, Ananias and Sapphira. She said, I've always felt sorry for them too. It's an interesting aspect, an interesting emotion there. Are we allowed to feel sorry for Ananias and Sapphira? Never struck me before. Is the story of Ananias and Sapphira supposed to engender some sort of pity in us? Or maybe we can think, as I do, if God is handing out this kind of punishment for hypocrisy, where do I stand with the things I've done? With the mistakes I've made when I haven't been a good witness to God? No thunderbolt, Lord, please. Let me finish this. Could Ananias and Sapphira have been us? Do you know, if this was an Old Testament story, I think we'd be quite comfortable with it, wouldn't we? Because in the Old Testament, there seemed to be God was angry a lot of the time, didn't he? And he did bring a lot of judgment. This is the New Testament. This is New Covenant stuff. We can't get away with it saying, oh, that's the Old Testament God. He was always angry. This is New Testament stuff. So does the punishment fit the crime? Are we allowed to feel a little bit of compassion for an Ananias or Sapphira? Because that could have been us. And after all, you know, it does say in Psalm 103, doesn't it? He's slow to anger, abounding in love. Come on, Lord. Do you know, God is not behaving here as we expect him to behave, is he? Not behaving as we expect him to behave. Let's be honest. We have expectations of God, don't we? But as we look through Scripture, really, those expectations are just blown out of the water like they are in our story this morning. In 1 Samuel 28, we see the story of the witch of Endor. When you look at that, theologically, none of it adds up, you know. Saul goes to the witch brings Samuel, who seems to be in a deep sleep. Samuel has a conversation. Well, that doesn't make sense historically or spiritually. Why does God have a dialogue with Nebuchadnezzar right through the early book of Daniel? Why is he on this ongoing conversation with Nebuchadnezzar? When Nebuchadnezzar is a heathen king who even built a statue in his own honor, and if people didn't bow to the statue, they were thrown into a fiery furnace. So why an ongoing conversation with somebody like Nebuchadnezzar? Why does God do stuff like that? I don't understand it, Lord. It doesn't fit in with my theology. God says, oh yeah, so what? Did you know, incidentally, if you ever want to impress somebody in a biblical quiz, you can tell them Nebuchadnezzar wrote Scripture. Nebuchadnezzar wrote the book of Daniel 4. Oh, it's all gone quiet. Check it out yourself. Daniel 4 is written by Nebuchadnezzar. But why does God have this ongoing conversation with Nebuchadnezzar when Nebuchadnezzar seems to be a heathen king? Why does God seem to endorse Isaac's blessing of Jacob, even though the act was done deceitfully? Does anyone here ever feel sorry for Esau? Esau's like the Old Testament Peter, isn't he? You know, as dull as doodah, but impulsive, but with a really good heart. He's like the Old Testament Peter. And Esau, as far as I can see, played the game, didn't he? He went to get the blessing. Jacob stole the blessing from him. Well, why would God endorse that? If Ananias and Sapphira were put to death for lying to the Holy Spirit, then why not Peter, who publicly disowned Jesus, didn't he? And sent curses on himself. I don't know who you're talking about. That was hypocrisy, wasn't it? Or Paul, who put a death sentence on all Christians in the name of God. That's hypocrisy, isn't it? Or Jacob, who deceived his father and said that God had helped him. That's hypocrisy, isn't it? What do we do when God is doing what we don't expect him to do? Sometimes we don't know why God is doing what he's doing, and we have to accept that. God is doing what he wants to do. It's always good. It's always good. If you don't hear anything from me this morning, hear this. God does not follow theology. God is theology. God does not follow theology. God is theology. His ways are not our ways. Isaiah 55. And we can thank God that his ways are not our ways, can't we? The longer I have known God, the less I know him. Ooh, you pastor, I thought you and God were tight. I try my best, but the longer I've known God, the less I know God. When you first saved, you think you've got God all wrapped up, don't you? I remember one of my first prayers to God was, oh, I'm so glad you've accepted me as your son, because I can like tell you a little bit of what's going on in the world, you know? The longer I've known God, the less I know him. Sometimes it's hard to work out what God is doing, but he is God and he is good. So this year, as this year starts, I totally concur with what David said earlier. Let's make a point of just whatever God is doing, even the stuff that we really don't understand, and even the stuff that he'll never explain to us. You know, maybe one day in eternity he'll take the time to explain to us. Maybe even Ananias and Sapphira will be in heaven. Who knows? Oh, he's getting controversial this morning. I better finish quick. But, you know, don't worry about it. God's not going to explain himself to you. Probably not. And God's never going to apologize either. Okay, so let God be God. Let God be the theology, because everything he does is good. As Anne was saying when we were having prayer on New Year's Eve night, trust, 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 trust. Let's trust God as 2021 goes on. We may not understand him. Sometimes we have no idea what's going on, but it's good. What he's doing is good. And what he's doing is because he loves us. Amen? Amen. I'm just going to pray as we pray.